is Mark.
Hi, Mark. This is Alex calling from Beyond Reality Radio. How you doing?
I'm doing well. How about you?
I'm good. The guys are ready for you, so I'm going to put you on hold and pass you over to them, okay?
Let's do it.
It's time to rejoin Beyond Reality Radio with Jason and JB.
And here we go. Another great night of paranormal radio, paranormal talk. It's Jason and JB on Beyond Reality Radio. We haven't said our nightly hello to everybody in chat, but hello to everybody in chat. Good to see you all there.
Big shout out to everybody listening online, listening from the chat room, just tuning in off the website, or listening on any of the many, many great stations we air on across the country. And we're not airing on a station in your area yet. Be prepared, because come January, it looks like we're going to jump up another 100 plus channels, if not, you know, well more than that. And most likely we'll be on one within your area. And I guess shortly after that, what, Jim, even overseas, right?
Yeah, that's what we're planning. That's the what we're being told. And we're working hard with additional syndicators so that we can get stations all across the country and the world. So we're excited about that. I did want to mention, Jay, that during the break, we had a caller who didn't want to go on the air. Who wanted to just mention that they had heard that even the people at Pearl Harbor were aware of the impending attack. Now, I don't know how many, because I know a lot of the soldiers were taken off guard. But he said that he'd heard reports that a lot of the Japanese residents or people of Japanese descent had left prior to the attack, as though they knew it was coming. I don't know. I haven't heard that before, but I wish he would have gone on the air with us. We could have chatted a bit. But
well, I had heard reports at one point that the Japanese had said something similar like, "Yeah, the people should get out of there because something's eventually going to happen." And that's interesting. I wish he had come on and actually shared that bit of information. But
yeah,
it is what it is.
It's a neat perspective. But okay, let's bring our guest for the night in. This is Mark Sargent. Mark is the creator of the Flat Earth Clues series on YouTube. Mark, welcome to Beyond Reality Radio. We've got a lot of people with a lot of questions. We're happy to have you on the show.
Hey, guys. Thanks very much for having me.
Thanks for coming on. We look forward to talking with you.
Yeah, so before we get too involved in the clues and what you do on YouTube and what you've presented, explain to us exactly what the Flat Earth Theory is first.
The Flat Earth Theory, which has seen quite a revival since the beginning of 2015, is basically saying that we live in an enclosed system. The easiest way for anyone to visualize this would be to look at the 1998 Truman Show, which was done on, I don't know, like, say, a 20-mile-wide scale. And imagine if that expanded all the way out to, you know, 10,000 miles or more, and that we literally live in a giant Hollywood studio. That's basically the long and the short of it.
So, I mean, I'm hearing two different things, and please just help guide me so I understand it.
Uh-huh.
One part of this is actually that the Earth is not a globe, but it's actually it's flat.
Yep.
Like, you know, people pre-Columbus were thinking.
Yep.
And the other part of this is that there's an entertainment component in that, if you're comparing it with the Truman Show, you're saying that this is kind of a stage that we're kind of performing on for somebody's benefit.
Well, you know, that's funny, because it could be sort of like that. I mentioned the Truman Show only because it's easy for people to relate to. As far as the actual reason why we're in, you know, what could be a giant snow globe or shallow sports stadium, it's really anybody's guess. But yeah, I mean, the default aspect of it being underneath this thing is that it's flat. You know, the Truman Show was on a giant flat structure. So that's where we're coming from right now.
So, Mark, then just so I know 100%,
yep,
beyond a doubt, do you firmly believe this, or is this just something that you're looking into?
No. Believe me when I say this, and I apologize, because your chat lines when I say this are probably going to blow up if they're not already blowing up now, because there's a lot of hostility out there towards this, and you got to wonder why. I never wanted to do this. I used to play video games for a living and taught people tech support stuff, and it was really
Wait a minute. How do I get a job playing video games? Because I'll sign on right now.
Any openings?
I'll work for half of what you were getting.
I got a lot of that people that told me that. I got into it because I won a computer game tournament years ago, and the company that produced the game hired me as a ringer. And then I went around, you know, Macworld and E3 and different gaming conventions and made games look better than they were. But I loved what I did. And when this thing came along, I was kind of a conspiracy guy, you know, off and on for the last 20 years. And when I looked into this thing, I did not wake up one morning and say that flat earth is the greatest thing since sliced bread. I woke up and I said, well, okay, this thing's a piece of crap. Everybody knows that flat earth's not true. I'm going to debunk it. Everybody that's in the community right now starts out trying to debunk this thing. And I'm warning anyone that's listening, you know, if you want to stay away from this thing, don't look in the box. Do not look in Pandora's box, because I did. And then I worked on it for about 9 months and then finally just gave up. And I said, you know what? I'm going to go the other way. And February of last year, I created a series of videos, put them out there called Flat Earth Clues. Honestly thought some scientist or astrophysicist or an astronomer would just blow this thing out of the water in 2 seconds. And not only did they not do that, but immediately I started getting subject matter experts that were calling me, say, you know, from different aspects of the community, saying, oh, yeah, you know, I think you're on to something. Started getting interviewed, got a book, got, you know, podcasts. I have 3 apps. I didn't ask for any of these things. And you guys contacted me and here I am. But yeah, sorry, that's the long roundabout answer for me saying, yeah, I absolutely believe that, you know, it may not be perfectly flat and the snow globe model, you know, the community we don't all agree on what's going on there, but one thing we absolutely agree is it's not a globe spinning through space. We believe the heliocentric model has just gone. It's not there anymore. It's geocentric all the way.
Really?
Okay. Not kidding.
So- I'm a little mind blown with that whole thing, because and you put it out there very, very professionally and passionately, where yeah, a lot of people we talk to, and you're sitting there, yeah, whatever, okay, the inner earth theory and the hollow earth theory and all these things, but you put it out there very passionately and professionally, and I look forward to listening to explain it to
us. And by the way, I used to be, that was really what got me into it, was I was kind of looking into the hollow earth thing, because I thought that was kind of interesting. And when I was looking into it, I looked up a guy, not to go off on a little tangent here real quick, looked up a guy named Richard E. Byrd, which was the youngest United States admiral of all time.
Yeah.
And everyone knows.
Admiral Byrd, yeah.
Admiral Byrd, he's tied to the hollow earth theory. And then I'm reading and I was going, wait, why is everything pointing down to Antarctica? And he spent basically the latter part of his life, 1928, all the way up until his death in 1957, in Antarctica, looking for something. And when he found whatever it was in the Operation Deep Freeze in 1955, 1956, the world changed. And everything started moving, the governments of the world started making weird decisions, and they all started pointing to the same thing, and that's how I kind of built the clues. I believe me, I tried to debunk this thing for the longest time, and then finally I said, you know, when did we actually find out it was a globe? How did we know, how does the person that's listening right now, how do you know it's a globe? Because everything else we can test. It seems like a pretty simple statement. You know, fire burns, water is wet, you drop something, it falls to the ground, that appears to be gravity. But when it comes to the universe and the solar system, that's something you're told. And not just something you're told by everybody, it started out with the American government, more specifically the United States military. NASA's a part of the DOD. Always has been, and they're uniquely military, but that's, you know, I could go off on other tangents. Anyway, sorry. I'm sure you guys got questions.
Well, no, but
go ahead.
Well, yeah, first off, let me just for everybody out there listening, when you're talking flat earth, now you're not talking where, you know, a long time ago they used to think that it was pretty much like a square, you'd fall off the side, done. You're talking more like a plate. Or a hubcap
so,
design, right?
So yeah, so it's not like the old version where, you know, we all see pictures, you know, of the sailboats falling off the edge and the water spilling off on all sides and everything. This appears to be more like a you know, a flat dinner plate, although, you know, some people have initially said it's kind of shaped kind of like a roulette table, but I'm not supposed to say roulette table anymore, because if you add up all the numbers in a roulette table, it adds up to 666. Another story for another time. But
jeez, wow, okay.
Yeah, I know, right? I was told not to ever bring up roulette table again because of that. But it's true.
Having coffee with you, if Jimmy and I could ever sit down and just have coffee with you, I think the world would change. So let's go. Keep on going.
Okay, so what is, if you want to envision it, you know, imagine again the Truman Show. So it's enclosed. You know, that's my take on it. There's other people in the community that say, well, no, there may not be an enclosure. There may not be a firmament, you know, that's mentioned in Genesis. But what if you took a globe and you put your hand on the North Pole and flattened it and then cut around the edges? And so the North Pole would be the center of this dinner plate. And then the continents would spread out kind of organically from the center. The only continent that would really not fit in, you know, that doesn't look anything like the map is Antarctica. So you're saying, yeah, because where's Antarctica in this case? Well, the Antarctic is actually not just this continent that looks kind of like Australia at the bottom. It's actually this giant, it's way bigger than people think, and it's spread around the entire edge of this thing. Like a giant ice wall, for lack of a better term. And so, no, nothing falls off the edge because the Antarctic coastline, which is really unique, and I could talk about this forever. The Antarctic coastline, which is really, really unique, slopes up 200 feet right off the beach, you know, because most of the cases there is no beach. And then the altitude really starts climbing up to about 14,000 feet right away and plateaus at 14,000 feet. Most of it, you know, there's no indigenous plant life, no animal life. But what's interesting about it is that there's a treaty in place that was put in after Operation Deep Freeze when Admiral Byrd went down there in 1959. Same, by the way, same year that Van Allen radiation belts were announced, and a whole nother tangent. But in 1959, the Antarctic Treaty was put in place that says that no corporation anywhere in the world, no matter how much money you have, you know, let's say one of you guys owns an oil company and you want to go down there, you're not allowed to go down there ever for anything, ever. And I mean, every country that comes on as an economic power is forced to sign this thing. And it's not even up for debate until 2041. It's the longest treaty of all time. It's the only one that's unilaterally ratified by every economic power. No one contests it. Nobody even argues about it. You'd think that, like, the president of Exxon would run a full page ad in the New York Times, you know, for, you know, every month, and say, why, it'd be great for Exxon to go down to Antarctica. Never going to happen. You're not even allowed to talk about it. And you're saying, well, what does that make a difference? You know, Antarctica doesn't have anything. That's not true. When Admiral Byrd, he went on television, you can look this up on YouTube, it's, you know, public knowledge. He goes on a show called the Long Jeans Chronoscope in 1954, just before he went down, you know, for Operation Deep Freeze. And he says, oh yeah, Antarctica is made out of money. He goes, there's an entire mountain range made out of coal, can fuel the entire world for years. There's oil, there's uranium, there's minerals. There's at least a dozen countries down there.
Okay, Mark, I gotta stop you just a second.
Yeah.
We have to take a break. When we come back, we'll continue the conversation. It's Mark Sargent. We're talking about the flat Earth theory on Beyond Reality Radio with Jason and JV.
You don't even want to know. Welcome back to Beyond Reality Radio. If you could see what I could see, that's all I'm saying.
Oh, what? You like that? Come on. Yeah. The song was I Touch Myself.
You were absolutely doing
that. Oh, God. We could never do like a television show together because... Like if I ever had you on my TV show, it would have been canceled. I would have never made it 11 seasons. We would have been canceled after two.
We'd have to go HBO. It's the only place we would do it.
Yes.
Welcome back to Beyond Reality Radio, Jason and JV. Before we bring Mark back in, I actually want to go right to the phone lines because we've got Ralph from Florida, and apparently we didn't get the information quite right about the Pearl Harbor comments. Hey, Ralph, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me on.
Thanks for calling back in.
Last time I was on your show, I blew it, but it's hard for me to stay on point. I am very nervous.
No, don't be. But don't be, Ralph.
I got to act like I'm just talking to a friend of mine. But my dad was NSA, and I was actually born in Japan, and naval base in Yokosuka. But anyway, I was told a lot of things, and I have a lot of stuff written down. I don't have anything in front of me, but about 2 weeks before the attack on Pearl Harbor, the whole carrier force was moved out of Pearl Harbor, and it was supposedly went on a exercise and off of the coast of Australia. And that included subs, you know, tenders, destroyers, light cruisers, and everything. And that was all kind of fishy. And at the same time, all the ambassadors, Japanese ambassadors, were also exiting. Now, I'm not talking about Japanese civilians on the island. Japanese ambassadors all shut their books and said, you know, we're done with this, and they left immediately. And, like, you know, days before the attack. And they did it very, very slick. And, I mean, it's all there. It's there for anybody that wants to really read about it. It is all there.
Well, and that's what I brought up earlier. That's why there's just so much evidence now when you look back. There's so much evidence to support that we knew ahead of time about the attack in Pearl Harbor, and that it was more just used to thrust us to sort of get the public to agree and just out of anger be like, enough is enough. All right, let's get involved in this war. So, yeah, there's just a lot of different things there.
Hey, Ralph, thanks for sharing that with us and calling in and setting the record straight. We really appreciate that. We got to let you go because we got to get to our guest, Mark back here, Mark Sargent, creator of the Flat Earth Clues series on YouTube. Mark, you were in the middle of talking about you know, some of the early information here, and I cut you off abruptly.
Oh, no worries.
Pick it up where you left off.
No worries. So, and that's when I, let me back it up just a little bit. And that is when I went at this thing, I, again, total globalist, you know, totally, believed in everything, believed in the American space program, rah, rah, go team. And, you know, huge science fiction fan, huge conspiracy guy. And when I went at this, I kind of treated it like a court case. And I noticed that when it came to all other conspiracies, you know, there was pros and cons, but when it came to Flat Earth, it was science versus, you know, basically a silent defense. And so, you know, being a dummy that I am and curiosity killed the cat, you know, I looked basically, you know, I just kind of rummaged around the science side's briefcases, you know, as a matter of speaking. And when I was looking in there, everything kept pointing back to NASA because, you know, a lot of people, including the people in your chat, says, oh, dude, you know, the ISS is running a live feed right now and everything is pointing back to NASA. And I was going, okay, how can you prove? And I asked a scientist this in a debate a few months ago, and I said, can you prove the Earth is a globe from the ground? Or you can you prove it? And he goes, I can't do it from the ground. And I said, why not? And he goes, you can't do it. You can't prove it's a globe from the ground. You have to go to space. And I go, okay, can you prove it's a globe without using the word NASA? You know, in anywhere. And I'm throwing NASA in any other space agency. NASA was the first one. They were created in 1958. Because like everyone else, I said, well, NASA's got all the info, so they've got to be correct. You know, they should have tons and tons, I mean, volumes, truckloads of information. And I started going through it, and I was going, wait a minute, there's really not much here. I mean, you're going through boxes and boxes and boxes of metaphorical information, and there's just nothing there. I'll give you a couple of perfect examples. Like, most people don't know that there was only one full, you know, blue marble shot picture taken of the Earth from 1972, supposedly Apollo 17, the last mission on the way back. Guys couldn't take any other pictures from Apollo 8 through Apollo 16, couldn't take any pictures. But Apollo 17, all the way up until the middle of last year, there was not a single, there was only one shot taken of the Earth. And they milked that thing, and we've all seen it. You guys would probably recognize it.
Sure.
You know, it's the one that shows the bottom part of Africa and then the entire continent of Antarctica. It was really odd that the only continent you're going to show in its entirety isn't Antarctica, considering it's the U.S. space program. Why not show the North Americans? And we confirmed this because during the middle of last year, the second blue marble shot was taken, supposedly from a million miles away from this telescope. 43-year gap. And we're going, you know, it's why did you guys take so long? And of course, you know, we look at it as, you know, kind of like the angry wife syndrome. It's like you can't give us flowers after not giving us flowers for 40 years and say, oh yeah, the marriage is saved. You know, you only showed the second shot because we asked it. Where was the picture for 43 years? There was no video of the Earth rotating on its axis until last year. Literally, in fact, it was almost within a month of that still shot that was taken. As in fact, the only shot that NASA even partially laid claim to was the 1990 Galileo footage, which showed the Earth rotating for 24 hours. The problem is that the weather didn't morph. The weather didn't change on that image for 24 hours. So what the heck happened? There's no footage of any rocket leaving or entering Earth's atmosphere with the camera running that doesn't stop, you know, the unedited footage. You know, the camera, you know, we've got, you could put a GoPro 4K camera on top of anything nowadays. There's no footage of this. On top of that, we'll throw out one more. There's no video of any astronaut taking a 180-degree or better pan outside of a spacecraft from any mission, from Mercury all the way through the ISS, even now. You know, you would thought it's like, you know, turn on the camera, spin around in the moon, turn on the camera, walk around the ISS. Never happens. Never has ever happened. It's going, look, that would have happened at least by accident. A lot of time. Go ahead.
Well, real quick, because we got to take a break in just about 30 seconds. But I fly a lot of drones. I put in, sometimes we head out to areas 800 miles away from airports, and I put them 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 feet up in the air.
Sure.
And I get the oval. I get a rounded shape that appears. Now, just think of that before, because we got to go to break. But when we come back, I'd really like your theory on why I would get sort of a rounded shape. So
I already got it.
When
sure,
we're that
ahead.
High up. But okay. You're listening to Jason and JV. We're going to take a real quick break, and when we come back, a lot more questions from Mark on this whole flat Earth theory. So we'll be right back after these messages. Hey, welcome back to Beyond Reality Radio with Jason Hawes and JV Johnson. And we're talking with Mark Sargent. And Mark actually does the Flat Earth Clues, which delves into the possibility of our human civilization actually being inside a Truman Show-like enclosed system and how it's been hidden from the public since 1956. Now, thanks for hanging with us, Mark.
Oh, yeah. No problem.
So before we went to break, I was talking to you about drones. I use a lot of drones. And, you know, a lot of times, well, I will head way out to deserted areas far away from airports and try to run them to their max, get them up as high as possible. And, you know, I probably shouldn't be saying this because the FAA wouldn't appreciate it. But the highest we've ever gotten, we've got up about 7,200 feet.
Sure.
And you know, where I can still see everything going on, we're running goggles and they're being the image projecting back down on. Now, when I get up that high, you can see sort of the orbiture of the Earth.
Yep.
You can see the roundness.
Yep.
Now, how can we explain that when it comes down to the flat Earth theory?
Just about all drones and a lot of your high altitude research projects, not all of them, but some of them will use a fisheye or what's also known as a peephole lens to give you a bigger perspective. And so when you're up there, and I'll give you some examples here. Like, did you guys happen to check out that Red Bull jump that happened recently, fairly recently? The guy that went up in that capsule and then
jumped? I remember that. Sure. Yes.
Okay. Yep. Same sort of thing. So we've gotten that question, you know, since week one, which is the Red Bull jump shows a severe curvature of the Earth, which, you know, way, and I'll give you the curvature formula here in a second. But I can also show you footage from a weather balloon at 120,000, 125,000. The Red Bull, I think, was at about 130,000 feet. But other weather balloon footage with a standard lens, it's flat as a board. And I put this challenge out to anyone, you know, last year. And I said, look, because some people say, well, no, I see the curvature from the beach, or I see it from a mountain, or I see it from a plane, even though I've talked to an Air Force pilot, an Army pilot, a flight instructor out of Iowa. They all say, no, it's flat as a board when you get up there. But I put the challenge. I said, look, if anyone thinks they see the curvature in anything, you know, with your naked eye, you know, if you're not going through a GoPro lens or something like that, you know, take a picture of it. Put it on your laptop, put a straight edge up to it. If you see a curvature on there, you know, by all means, you know, send it to me, email it to me, and I'll quit Flat Earth right now. And that challenge was put out, I don't know, a year and a half ago, and it's not there. Now, to be fair, though, because I'll use Neil deGrasse Tyson, who came out against this thing in January of this year after B.O.B., that Grammy-nominated rapper, made a song and an album about Flat Earth. And Neil deGrasse Tyson tried to light him up on Comedy Central. Neil said that basically you can never get high enough in anything that isn't NASA to see the curvature and from side to side. And I, you know what? I'll go with him on that, because the world is a very, very big place and you would have to get up very, very high to see the curvature, because the curvature is only 8 inches per mile squared. And for those of you who are listening, and I'm not trying to scare you guys with any weird math here, that just means 8 inches times each mile times itself. So at 2 miles, it's 2 times 2, which is 4 times 8 is 32 inches. 3 times 3 is 9 times 8 is 72. And you see it gets, you know, it's more severe and more severe to where at, let's say, 100 miles, it's about, I don't know, just under 7,000 feet of curvature. Which means, so on side to side, you're not going to be able to see much because we can only see, you know, from horizon left to right, you're not going to be able to see that much. But forward and back, you should be able to see. You should be able to measure the curve. And people say, well, yeah, I've seen boats. You know, this is where the whole boat falling off the edge thing. I've seen a boat go off into the distance, head away from the beach, and it disappears over the horizon. Therefore, it's gone over the curvature. I go, yeah, you could have gotten away with that maybe 15, 20 years ago. But most recently, especially with the really high zoom cameras that are out there, you can tell, you know, that boat should be gone. You look, you watch, and then you get a pair of binoculars, that thing's gone. Then you take out like those cool pics 900 things or with a 70x zoom. You zoom in, that boat's there again. And it should be long gone. And we, to this point, we're now seeing stuff. And I put the challenge out to science, I don't know, about 6 months ago now. I go, find me an object on the other side of a body of water, you know, because it's sea level. Water is flat, you know, with exception of weather. Find me an object on the other side of that water that we can't see. And I'll give you an American example, because I imagine most of your listeners are American. The Chicago skyline from the other side of Lake Michigan, about 50 miles away, give or take. And depending on what beach you're looking at, if you go down the beach and, you know, you can look at it. It's 50 miles away. 50 miles is, you know, 50 times 50 times 8 inches divided by 12. You're talking about a little less than 2,000 feet of curvature. That skyline should be gone, should be not there. And some people say, well, no, it's a mirage. You know, it's an optical illusion. It's refraction. It's whatever you want to call it. It's like, yeah, maybe. But I've seen time lapse 12 hours from that very very beach of the Chicago skyline through, you know, it goes through light and darkness and inclement weather. There's clouds going through, you know, the thing doesn't waver. When it gets to darkness, you know, the resolution's good enough. You can actually see the cleaning crews working their way down. The point is that we're seeing objects that should be on the other side of the hill. I'll give you one more example. One of my subject matter experts, again, these people were calling me up completely unsolicited. I've got like 20 different guys now. One of the first ones, though, was brilliant. He was a Navy missile instructor, 10 years in, trained people in the Sparrow missile system. And he goes, I'm totally on board with this. You know, he gave out his name. He wasn't even anonymous. He goes, when you're using a Sparrow missile system, you're going ship to ship. And he's going, look, we can fire. He goes, I won't tell you the classified stuff, but we're going ship to ship at about 60 miles, you know, 50 nautical miles, maybe 60 land miles. And he goes, we're painting that target. You know, when you're using a Sparrow missile system, you're painting it with a beam radar, about 2-inch beam radar. He goes, that's as straight as you can get. And we're going ship to ship, which is, you know, right there on the water. He goes, that thing should be long gone over the curve. Now, unless you're telling me that the gravity of the Earth is bending that beam radar perfectly so we can hit that ship every time and lock those missile systems in, he goes, I'm not buying it. He goes, we don't calculate that in there. We don't calculate for the curvature of the Earth when we're doing it, nor do we even account for the spinning of the Earth, otherwise known as the Coriolis effect. And that's when all the, you know, I had a flood of military guys call me, you know, artillery guys, tank guys, Air Force, name it. I got all branches and they all said the same thing. They said, no matter what you're shooting, I don't care if it's a sniper all the way up to a, you know, 60 mile missile or a cannon. He goes, you do not account for the Coriolis effect. You just don't do it. It's mentioned, you know, it's one of those things. It's like, oh yeah, everyone's heard of it, but no one uses it in their 9-to-5 job. One more real quick. And that is a surveyor that I had who called me up. There's two types of surveyors out in the world. There's a planar surveyor and a geodetic surveyor. Planar surveyors handle about 95% of the projects that are out there. And he goes, it's weird. He goes, it's called a planar surveyor because you treat the world like it's absolutely flat. And as a rookie, he said, well, wait a minute. Don't we have to account for the curvature? They said, don't worry about it. As long as your project comes out fine, you don't have to take into account. And he goes, that doesn't make sense, because if you're building a city, you know, 20 miles wide, and you're dealing with all sorts of different, you know, things that are butting up from the north, south, east, and west, you know, it's like putting crackers on a basketball, like wheat thins on a basketball. You're going to get things that aren't going to butt up perfectly against each other because these projects are perfectly flat. He goes, it's never used in real life. Everyone's heard about it, but no one uses it. Anyway, sorry. I get.
It's great. We've got a lot of questions, and we've got some phone calls we want to go to as well. And we're going to bring Ralph in from Boston, actually East Boston. Ralph, welcome to Beyond Reality Radio.
How you guys doing?
Great, thanks.
Hey, good. Welcome to the show.
Mark, I just want to say you're one of my heroes, pal. I've been following you. How's this? If it wasn't for the clues, I would have never got introduced to
how
the Flat Earth.
How did you know I was on this show tonight? I didn't even announce it anywhere.
I listen to it every night.
Thanks a lot, Mark. Thanks a lot, Mark, for not announcing you're going to be on
and
our show.
When I heard Mark Sargent Flat Earth, I was like, you've got to be kidding, because every time I mention that, the Jason and JV, for some reason, my phone call gets cut short. Like I'm a wacko or something. What? I've brought it up several times.
Well, I don't know. I don't remember that.
Thank you very much. Thank you for listening to everything I've done so far. I'm flattered.
Well, just every time, like I'm on these conspiracy things all the time on YouTube, and it always pops up recommended for you.
Yeah.
And it was you. And of course, I rolled my eyes and laughed, but I'm like, all right, 10 minutes debunked. Two days later, on the third day, I was a flat earther.
Yeah.
And it's like, I couldn't sleep. That's how much it affected me.
Yeah.
But you've already stole a lot of my thunder about the do not enter of Antarctica. And, if it wasn't for guys like you, Jaron, Rob Skiba, Morgyle, and Eric Dubay,
I'm
avid followers of all you guys.
Well, thank you, man.
I just want to say thank you very much.
Hey, you're very welcome, and it's much appreciated. Thanks for supporting.
Yeah, thanks for the call. Let's go to Rachel in Washington. Rachel, welcome to Beyond Reality Radio.
Hi, how are you?
Great. Good. Welcome to the show.
Hi. First of all, I just have to say, Jason Hawes, you are so awesome. I watch Ghost Hunters all the time. One of my favorite shows ever.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate it. And we had fun. 11 years. I mean, it's who would have thought that show would have kicked off so many, just kickstarted the whole genre of television.
Oh, my God. I swear I could talk to you probably for hours about some of the locations that you guys have gone to.
Well, that's
but
awesome.
my question tonight is okay, I like to think I have a pretty open mind when it comes to things like this. I'm just wondering, what about like the core of the Earth? Like how do these things not exist? Like, if the world is flat, we wouldn't have like a core of the Earth. And how would things stay where they're supposed to be? It just doesn't make sense to me if the world was flat.
I'd love to answer that one. And by the way, no offense to you guys, I don't actually announce that I'm going to do anybody's show in advance. I always tell them after the fact. I go, I have to go to this channel and listen to, all the stuff. I generally don't.
No, it's not a problem at all. I was only joking.
Oh, okay. I wasn't trying to insult you guys. Oh, these guys.
No, we're good.
No, as far as what your question, though, I actually made a clue about that. Because that was one of those things that I looked at, because the deepest hole ever drilled is 8 miles. And I thought, well, that's kind of weird, because, we all grow, growing up through school, we don't know the cross section of the Earth that looks like a gobstopper. It goes from red to orange to yellow to multi-white center. And I was going, wait a minute, how do they know that if it's 4,000 miles to the center of the Earth? How do they know what's down there if they only drilled down 8 miles? And then I started digging through some stuff, and even the wiki entry, it does this kind of like tiptoes around the thing. So, well, we're kind of extrapolating and speculating based on what comes up from volcanoes and stuff. So what I'm saying is, core of the Earth, they don't know what the core of the Earth is. But so you're wondering why when you open up your textbook, why the cross section of the Earth doesn't have a big question mark in the inside of it. That's because science doesn't like doing that. Science hates question marks. So they will, they'll say, well, we think this, and eventually they'll just let people assume that, that they're absolutely 100% sure on it. They don't know what's down there.
Yeah, Mark, I find that point very, very interesting, because there are many things we're taught from a scientific perspective that really are big question marks. And I don't want to go into it now, but even the theory of evolution, is something that we're taught as fact, and it's still some uncertainty as to how it all works. And there are so many of these things that are preached as scientific gospel, and we're told to believe them, but we're never shown why we should believe them.
Yeah, And I should let me segue that into the question that will eventually come up in chat, or someone's going to call about, and they're going to say, why? I'm waiting for somebody to call up angry and say, why? Why would they hide it? Why would they bother hiding it? And the big reason is because of what you just said there. It's because there would be a massive paradigm shift and science would be put into question. You know, forget about the economic and the spiritual side necessarily, but the academic side would just get turned upside down. You know, people would be looking at science to say, okay, so you were wrong about the shape of the earth, and you were talking about that for about 500 years. What else are you wrong about? The evolution thing? What's going on there? Carbon dating? Hey, what happened, you know, with that Big Bang? You know, and then they start, and then, you know, you look at the religious side, and, you know, then it gets a little dicey, because then you look at religion, it's like, okay, so you were right about this. And in fact, one of my people in the community, he's got a website called testingtheglobe.com, which talks about it strictly from a Christian point of view. And he just, you know, quotes everything in the Bible. And I was going, wow, that's amazing. I mean, it's fantastic work.
Well, we got a question from one of the chat room people who was asking, during a lunar eclipse, the shadow of the Earth that is cast on the moon is round, not flat.
Yep.
Just wondering if you have an explanation.
No different than a planetarium. And again, I know people are going to want to, you know, they're going to want to fight this tooth and nail. But when you go to a planetarium, I had people say, well, you know, I've seen the moons of Jupiter, you know, with my binoculars or telescope. And I go, okay, fine. Go to a planetarium, and I know that dates me. Nobody goes to planetariums anymore. But if you go to a planetarium and you look up and you take a pair of binoculars with you and you're looking at Jupiter, do the binoculars make it look more or less real? And they say, well, it doesn't matter because you're inside a planetarium. I go, yeah, who's to say when you walk out of that one, you aren't in a bigger one? And to circle back to your question, when it comes to the phases of the moon, the whole waxing and waning thing, or about the blood moon. Blood moon shouldn't even be able to exist because there is no Earth between the sun and the moon. When it comes to anything in the sky, you're just looking at a giant display system. No different than the Truman Show in some aspects. But this one's kind of a combination planetarium, terrarium, wildlife preserve, whatever you want to call it. But everything in the sky is a display system, a very, very good one.
All right, Let's bring in Steve from Florida. Steve, you're on Beyond Reality Radio.
Yeah, thank you for taking my call. And first off, Merry Christmas to you guys. And I'm just recently, I call it retarded, but I'm retired. So I turn on late night to keep my mind going.
Awesome.
Very interesting stuff. But I had another subject matter about the moon being round. I got a telescope. I can see it. Sun's round. You got NOAA. You can watch it 24/7. All these are live videos, but he just made a comment about everything is just a the planetarium or whatever.
Yeah.
But we have rovers on Mars right now.
Ah, yes.
So that's not just a spot up in the sky. That is real entities. Those are real things. Everything is round. You know, you also have gamma rays coming from the sun. So how do you, if you're flat, how do you generate your magnetic field to protect us?
Gotcha. Was that the question?
Great questions.
Okay, no, it's really good. I'll let me answer that one with a follow-up question, which I think is more interesting because I know we're limited for time, which is the Van Allen radiation belts. Deadliest thing supposedly ever announced by NASA employee, no figure, Van Allen back in 1959, the same year that they announced the Antarctic Treaty. I don't believe in coincidences. How did they get through them? Van Allen said himself that if you try to go through these things, you know, they are completely lethal to humans. And yet Apollo 8, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, in fact, the latter, six, made round trips through this thing. Nobody died. Nobody got radiation poisoning. Nobody got cancer. And yet when you ask NASA, you can try, and you say, whoa, hey, what shielding did you use to stop the radiation? And they won't answer you. They you just get dead air because there's only two. We all know, you know, there's two things that can stop radiation. One is lead. We wear those at the dentist's office and various doctor's offices. And the other one is gold, which happens to be, trivia, twice as dense as lead. The last thing you're ever going to do is put an anchor on top of a rocket. So the question is, what shielding did they use to get through the belts? You know, they will not talk about it. No one ever addresses it. It's never come up in any NASA documentary ever. As a matter of fact, I'll throw one more along those lines, which is, if you want to have some fun, because none of this is secret information, go to the NASA website and look up the video Orion Trial by Fire. The Orion Project, also known as the Mars Project, where it's like a 7-8 minute video, which I think aired on television at some point, where they were saying that they will have to send unmanned capsules through the Van Allen belt because they haven't figured out how to get through the radiation. And they were very specific about that. I'm going, what are you talking about? Why would you, what do you mean? Can't figure out how to get through the belt. You went through it in the 60s and nothing ever went wrong. So why are you having a problem with it now? Why, you know, just they're kicking the Mars thing down the road because they know they can't fake it. It's the Mars mission.
Well, and you know what?
Go ahead.
Well, we had just talked to our friend Stanton Friedman, who's a huge UFO guy.
Oh, I talked
and,
to Stanton.
We should
this.
We should ask him about that whole radiation, because I know he was saying that he worked on the actual panels to block it. So
I asked him that question. I got into a debate because I was supposed to debate some scientist, and they gave me Stanton Friedman, and he and I had some great discussions, but when I mentioned the Orion trial by fire thing, he was floored that video was even out there. And it's still out there now. It was done. It's not even an old video. It's October of 2014. So how are they doing? You know.
Okay.
Go ahead. Yeah. Sorry.
Go ahead. No, go right ahead. Finish.
Oh, the Mars rover, for example, that your caller mentioned. Mars rover. Everyone knows how batteries work, especially car batteries. You know, they can get charged and discharged, but eventually they will die. And when a car battery dies, it dies forever. There's nothing you can do. You can hook up the Hoover Dam to it. It's not going to come back to life. That Mars rover battery should have died 7 or 8 years ago. Should have been dead to the world. And they just let that thing keep going. And throw one more. China supposedly has a rover on the moon right now. Supposedly been there since 2014. It's taking pictures of apparently nothing. They will not show footage of it because it is horrible.
Well, that's the one that supposedly is broken down due to the actual moon dust in it.
Oh, okay. Well, if it's broken down recently, cool. But why didn't they put that thing through the Sea of Tranquility? You know, the only thing interesting, if you believe in the Apollo program, which, you know, is one of the first things our community has to give up. And by the way, that was one of the things, thank God Flat Earth came along, because it was something that had been bugging me for the longest time. No offense if you guys are big NASA fans. But because people...
Hey, Mark, just hold on, because we got to go to break. And
okay.
We've got more callers, more questions, and a lot more discussion to come. We're talking with Mark Sargent, who's the creator of the Flat Earth Clues series on YouTube. It's Beyond Reality Radio with Jason and JV. Don't go away. More to come. Well, we're having some fun. I can tell you that. It's Beyond Reality Radio with Jason and JV. We're talking about Flat Earth theory, and it's generating a lot of comments and chat, a lot of phone calls, and a lot of questions.
Yeah, and it's an interesting topic. I thought when we were talking about this earlier, Jim, I was like, we're going to be talking about what? How are we going to fill up 2 hours? And now I'm wondering, we could have a third.
Yeah.
But Mark, hey, real quick, another question for you, though, is how can we have these things where people do, you know, people are flying around the world or they're sailing around the world. I, as a boat guy, I work really close with my GPS, but, you know, and I'm also very familiar with boating. I've spent most of my life on boats.
Yep.
So I know that if I leave New England and I head straight across, I know where I'm going to end up.
Yep.
I know that if I keep on going, eventually I'll come back to the West Coast of the United States. How does this work then for people who are flying around the globe?
Oh, no worries. And I know these questions by heart because I've gotten them literally since people thought I was crazy last year. When it comes to sailing around the world or flying around the world, two aspects, different though. One is when you move your finger in a circular pattern around the dinner plate, you are going around the dinner plate. Does that make the dinner plate a sphere? No, it does not. But when it comes to the GPS system, which is also very curious, because the more I dug into that, the more I realized, like, holy smokes, you know, talk about a Matrix reference. But the GPS works for the system. The GPS was designed by, again, the United States DOD back in the 90s. And not only, yeah, it's helpful in some ways, but it also can work for them in showing you where they want you to think that you are when it comes to long-distance flights. So, and I did a clue. You know what? I don't want to go on this tangent because I'm going to miss too many questions. I could go with the GPS, but look up the clues. I have two clues on this. One is called the long haul, and the other one's called the magic show, where it shows how the GPS system completely drops off when it comes to planes about 150 miles offshore and doesn't blink back on again until you get about 150 miles within the your destination, and everything else goes into approximated or estimated mode, and that range happens to be coincidentally about the same distance as maximum land-based radar range. We're saying that the GPS system really isn't satellite-based. It's just the old Loran system with a different wrapper on it. That's it.
Okay. Let's go to Ben in Louisiana who has a question. Ben, welcome to Beyond Reality Radio. Great to have you on the show.
Hey, guys. It's a beautiful night down here in the South Louisiana. I hope you guys have one, too. My question is, well, I guess more of a observation. I'm an RF guy. I've been in oil field telecommunications for oil and gas industry stuff for about 15 years now, and a lot of that involves high-frequency radio.
Sure.
And I heard you speaking earlier about, munitions guys not taking into account curvature of the earth to hit targets. But, I mean, just in practice, if I'm doing a long-range radio shot at, say, 24 gigahertz, on a receive and transmit standpoint, your shot's about the size of a dime. If I don't account for the curvature of the earth, my radios are not going to link up when it comes to setting up the elevation for them. So I'm just...
So are you
being skeptical, but
no, it's okay. And believe me when I say this to anyone that's out there, look, I'm not trying to convince you this is a 2-hour show. All I'm trying to do is, create reasonable doubt for the globe. When I say these things, I do not plan to walk away without everyone, chanting flat earth and walking down the street. So when it comes to your radio frequencies, are you bouncing off of any atmosphere layers, or when you're doing this, are you hitting off the thermo or the isosphere or anything?
No, that stuff actually started, the old super long range stuff that kind of phased out before I started getting into this field. But I'm talking just, a 30-mile radio shot. If you don't account for that, for the curvature, you can't just set this up in a straight 90-degree angle. It's never going to link up.
So
I have to physically make these things point down to reach out and touch each other.
To point down. So when you're shooting. No, go ahead. What sort of distance are you talking about?
I'm just speaking from a purely I've physically done this myself standpoint. I've had my hands on these things for a while now. So I still have the same argument. I've flown around, pardon the expression, around the globe, several times over the course of my work and travels. I'm just curious from a physical, if I have a piece of equipment and I put it at a 90-degree angle pointing straight out, it is not going to speak to the other piece of equipment that is pointing 90 degrees straight out. It just doesn't happen. I have to physically make these things account for even a very slight over that distance, a very slight curvature.
Email me the equipment that you're using, because all I can tell you is all the guys I've talked to, from the electronics guys I was talking to, and some of these guys are using some pretty beefy equipment. They're doing straight shots. So I don't know what to tell you there. I'd have to look more at I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, Ben, we'll put you on hold, Ben, and Alex or Slick will get your email address, and then you can communicate with
Can I answer a second?
Oh, yeah, that would be great, because I'm curious, I like to keep an open mind about everything. I'm a live and let live guy, I'd like to hear more.
I want to address his second thing about the plane flight. So I've done a lot of business travel myself. When you get up to cruising altitude and it goes and you're going, you're set at cruise. Here's the big thing when it comes to planes, right? So you're talking in 100 miles, you're talking about 7,000 feet of curvature. And yet I have never been in a plane at cruising altitude, because we can all, human beings are bad at relative motion, but we can tell when things dip and rise. You dip 500 feet, even in a commercial aircraft, over a slow amount of time, you're going to notice it. That plane should be adjusting for the curvature all the time. And I don't care how good an autopilot it is, you're going to feel some of it. And, even if it's 7,000 feet, a commercial jet can cover 100 miles quickly. We've set up instruments on really long flights and those things don't even budge. Everything from sophisticated iPhone instruments to just a bubble level with a cam on it. And that sucker never moves. When you get up to cruising altitude, you are flying perfectly, absolutely level. I encourage anyone to look into the gyros on planes, which, again, I've talked to three different pilots, you know, not just people that fly, but actual pilots. They all say the same thing. They're saying the instruments say that it's flat.
Well, no, and I'd have to, and I understand what you're saying. As a friend who, I have friends who are pilots, and I've been on their plane, and when we're up in the air, I mean, if he's at 20,000 feet,
yeah.
It's not like he has to keep on, you know, adjusting to stay at 20,000 feet. So well, I see what you're,
yeah,
I see
and
what
that's
you're
a
saying
and
there,
that's
where
a...
if it was curved, he would have to.
Yeah.
But I'm, yeah, so I'm, I guess
I mean,
I'm not
you
sure
were...
enough with the length and so forth, you know, because there's hundreds and hundreds of miles.
Oh, yeah.
We're talking an Earth that's so many thousands of miles around, so
it's
going to be hundreds and hundreds of miles before he needs to really adjust on
well,
that. Okay, we're quickly running out of
– Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Hold on, Mark. We're quickly – yeah, it's okay. We're just running out of time, and we're trying to get all of this in. We've got – Jay has been on hold for a while from Florida. Jay, you're on with Mark Sargent.
Hey, guys. Okay, so once again, sol-war.ru to get a lot of truth about a lot of things that people have questions. They confirm that NASA is all lies. I don't remember what else they said about all this. Something else I wanted to point out that just dawned on me is the whole Christopher Columbus thing. We know that that's not true about with the Indians and how they say he discovered America and all of that. Well, think of how flat Earth was tied into all of that. And who's to say that right then and there, a liar conspiracy wasn't developed then, or even even before then? As far as you said with evolution, that is a lie of Satan, and you can see if they haven't taken him down. There's been physicists and scientists that admit that that was completely made up, including prominent scientists. Of course, there's global conspiracies with all governments. That's where you get the globalism. Globalists, Freemasons, the Illuminati, New World Order, UN, Council of Foreign Relations, Trilateral Commission, Bilderbergers, etc. What I was curious is if your guest has done anything to do with CERN and how they have been, what they've been doing with the firmament and cracking the shield, and if he knew any, if he could back any of this up or knew anyone else had. With scriptures in the Bible or any other religious texts or manuscripts such as the Sea Scroll, Tanakh, Septuagint, others like that. And remember, people, with the Illuminati hinting at us with their shows and movies, Under the Dome, the CBS show that was based on the Stephen King series, and that also had the alien pod taking over an invasion storyline elements to it.
Do you want to give Mark enough time to answer your question,
how much
Jay,
time,
because
how
we
much
have
time
break. We got about just over a minute.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, when it comes to – he brought up an interesting point, which is the American government and the Soviets after the 1956 supposed discovery of this thing, which was that the Americans and the Soviets, starting from 1958 till 1962, all they did was fire nuclear weapons straight up. And some of these suckers were really big, high altitude and megatons. So I think they were trying to, like guys would do. It's like, hey, there's a barrier there. Let's see if we can bust through it. That didn't work. How it ties in with his question. I think after that, they were going, okay, brute force isn't working. What else have you got? Well, you got HARP. That seems to work with frequencies. That's not doing too much. Maybe we can use it for weather modification. What else you got? How about CERN? Maybe we can just, you know, phase a hole through this thing. I don't know, but, you know, CERN, you know, super suspicious. Do I think it's tied to this in some way? Do I think that we're overall still trying to escape this thing? Some people are. I absolutely believe in that. And one last thing before you go to break, the UN flag, you know, everyone knows what it looks like. It has all the continents on it.
Sure.
There's something missing in the UN flag. It's Antarctica. Antarctica is not on the UN flag. You got to wonder why. How's that?
Interesting. All right, we're going to go to break, and we're going to keep you through this break as well, Mark. We haven't been able to get to all the questions, but I've got the million-dollar question when we get back. It's Beyond Reality Radio with Jason and JV. Don't go away.
After all the pain.
It's Beyond Reality Radio with Jason and JV. Our telephone number is 844-687-7669. We're having a terrific conversation with Mark Sargent about the Flat Earth Theory. When we come back from our break, we've got a few more questions and a few more minutes. It's Beyond Reality Radio with Jason and JV.
Welcome back to Beyond Reality Radio. Jason Hawes, J.B. Johnson. Our guest tonight has been Mark Sargent. We've been talking about the flat earth theory. We've had a lot of great conversation, and I've got two questions, Mark. One is, that's been in the chat room a few times, is how do we explain tides? You know, the moon is responsible for tidal activity on the earth.
No, that's a good one.
And a lot of people have asked that question, yeah.
Okay. When it comes to the moon, all right. How should I answer this without turning it into something long? When it comes to the tides, if this thing is artificial, then the moon cannot be the thing that's directly affecting the tides. Everything down here has got to be being affected from down here. And that means everything from the jet stream system, you know, with the upper atmosphere, that's got to be like a giant air conditioner. The underwater conveyor system, which is down in the, you know, the ocean currents, which also works very, very efficiently in a circular model instead of a sphere. And the same thing with the tides and everything that has to do with gravitational waves. So the moon, because it's got to be, it can't be 237,000 miles away and what is a couple thousand miles across. It's got to be, you know, it's got to be much, much smaller. And therefore, you know, you're not going to, if you were going to build this thing, you wouldn't want to make that thing, you know, like a direct gravitational lens. But on the same topic as the moon, not to get off on too much of a tangent, look into moonlight being cold. And by that, I don't mean that it's colder at night. I mean, look at moonlight is actually generating a cold, like a cool laser. We can do this now with technology. We couldn't do it like 20 years ago. And that is, everyone knows when it's 100 degrees in the sun, it's like 90 degrees in the shade. But if you are in the moonlight, right, let's say it's 60 degrees in the moonlight. If you go to the moon shade, it's actually warmer. It's actually, you know, like 70 in the moon shade. We've seen up to 13 degree swings, which should not be possible from a physics standpoint. If the sun is reflecting some of the sun, if the moon is reflecting some of the sun's rays, the last thing you would do, you certainly wouldn't see it generating cold light. And I was one of the first people who suggested this part of it because somebody, I didn't invent this, the community did. And I said, well, you know, do something fun. Take a magnifying glass. If you take a magnifying glass up to the sun, you can burn paper, ants, or whatever. You take a magnifying glass to moonlight, it actually gets colder, you know, than normal moonlight. It's fantastic. Anyway, sorry, next question.
All right, so the million-dollar question is, let's assume for a moment that this is all true.
Yeah.
There's a dome over us, and the Earth is flat. The question is, who built the dome and why?
Yeah, that is the number one question. Okay, and I don't want to upset any religious people, and I don't want to downplay any religion, because it can only be one of two things. It's either an advanced civilization, it's a big one since everyone knows about UFOs, why not, or it's something divine, But then again, when we're talking about an advanced civilization, how many layers do you have to go to before you get to God? Am I saying this is the handprint of God? Am I saying this is intelligent design? Not necessarily, but, there's a lot of people that have been looking into this, along those lines. It's like, is this proof of God? Which is, of course, why the reason you would want to hide it, because it's one of the rules of power you're not supposed to break, and that is never admit that there's somebody stronger than yourself. If you're at a certain level of power, it's why the Air Force never admits that there's UFOs, because the UFOs are better than their fighter planes. And you don't control the sky if you don't control the sky. Same thing with this thing. You don't want to admit that we were built, because that would imply that there's a creator. Somebody built it, and whoever built it means that they're more advanced than you. And the general population, it's tougher to control a general population if that is true. So that's what I'm kind of leaning for. But I can tell you this, it has brought a lot more people to spirituality in general. I'd be one of them. I'm not going to be a hypocrite and say otherwise. There's a lot of people that it's the only conspiracy I know that gives a message of hope. And that is that, that there could be, that we may not be alone. There may be something that's been looking over our shoulder all this time. It sounds something like a Twilight Zone episode, but science fiction is one of the things we're good at.
Well, Mark, it's been a fantastic conversation, a great discussion. We're just simply out of time. I think we asked 50 questions, and we probably have another 250 to ask if we had the time.
Yeah, we got to have you on again.
Oh, thanks, guys. I'd be happy to do it whenever.
What's the website and the YouTube channel people can check out some of your work?
You know, the easiest way, I could rattle off about half a dozen. Just go into any browser whatsoever and type in Flat Earth Clues. You will find me in one form or another, whether it's the free site, the subscription site, the podcast, the book, whatever. You will find it. But one thing I should throw in before we go, and that is when you type into any search engine, you type in Earth is, tell me what you see nowadays, because it didn't used to say Earth is flat. You're welcome. That's what we did recently.
All right, Mark, thanks so much for joining us. Great, great, great discussion, and we appreciate your time.
Thanks, guys, very much for having me.
Okay, Mark Sargent, and great conversation, Jay, and I meant that. I mean, we asked probably 50 questions, but there were probably another 200, 300 questions we could have asked.
He was willing to take any and all questions that were asked upon him. And again, I'm big on the whole, if you're willing to stand in there and take it, when somebody's asking you the hard questions and you're willing to take it and not get all defensive, that shows the kind of person you are. That shows your conviction in what you're talking about, what you're preaching, and your belief in it. And he did that. So I got to give him credit on that. And to be honest with you, he seems to enjoy what he's talking about. And he believes that. He believes that he can tell you answers for all the questions.
And I'll tell you that, you know, I mean, I went like you. I went in very skeptical into this conversation, but some of the things he points out make me wonder, and I want to do a little more research and learn a little more about it.
You're gonna go try to find the end of the world?
I'm gonna go see if I can jump off the end of the world. You'd like that, wouldn't you?
I don't know. I wouldn't have to hear about your thumb anymore. It would be a very sad day for me.
Don't forget, tomorrow night we've got a pre-recorded show, but it's going to be a good one.